Welcome to Thank You for Your Service. I am Tom Heiser and I will be your host. At the request of military authorities, the Red Cross sent teams of young female college students to Vietnam beginning in 1965 to conduct light entertainment and audience participation programs for service personnel. This program today is the story of one of a group of 627 amazing American women who volunteered to serve during the Vietnam War through the Red Cross as part of a program that was called Supplemental Recreation Activities Overseas, or SRO. Better known respectfully by the military men as donut dollies. Armed with nothing but cookies and homemade entertainment programs, the donut dollies risked their lives every day as they tried to fulfill their mission and cheer up U.S. troops. Despite their service and sacrifice, their stories and contributions to Vietnam have gone largely unnoticed and underappreciated. Today we will be talking to Diane Schufelt, who lives in central Wisconsin, who was a donut dolly during the Vietnam War. Diane, thank you for what you did. Thank you for your service. Why did you choose the Red Cross program?
Oh, that's kind of a long story. I was in college when Kennedy was assassinated. Wanted to join Peace Corps, and I wasn't old enough. My father wouldn't sign for me. So basically he said, finish school, stay in school, finish school. When you graduate, you can do anything you want to do. So during my junior year, I participated in a kind of like a domestic exchange program between my school in New Jersey and a college in California. When I was in California then, I learned about the Red Cross and this program, this SRAO program. And a friend of mine and I decided to do that after we graduated from school, from college. So we went in at age 22 when we graduated. So
when you joined this program, so when you joined the program, did you know you were going to Vietnam?
There was a choice. You could either sign up for Vietnam or Korea. And my friend says, should we go to Vietnam? And I guess that was my answer, yes. In addition to that, too, there were so many of our friends who had been drafted, had enlisted, whatever their circumstance was, and they were in Vietnam as well. So I don't know, it just seemed to be the thing to do at the time. It was the 60s. So that's my answer.
Okay. How old were you when you joined?
22. Just graduated from college.
What motivated you to do that, to join?
I graduated, and my friend as well. Friend of mine from New Jersey, from Montclair State, went in with me as well at the same time. And both of us wanted to teach eventually, but just didn't want to do it at that time. Wanted to do something else. I had considered joining, I think it was VISTA, Volunteers in Service to America. As I said, the Peace Corps. This just seemed to be something to work with American servicemen. And I guess at that time, the Peace Corps wasn't as important to me, at that time was not as important to me as supporting service people. So that was it. That was, I guess, my motivation. Something to do for the United States, something to do for service people.
Okay, so where were you living when you joined?
I grew up in Elizabeth, New Jersey. So went to school in Jersey, went to school for my junior year in California, came back to Jersey for my senior year, and then left for Washington, D.C. first, and then to Vietnam.
So this program is made up with college graduate
Correct.
Females.
Yes.
So what college did you graduate from, and what was your major?
Montclair State College. My major was business administration / education.
Okay. And how long after college, after your graduation, before you went in? Did you go in right away?
I graduated June of 67, and I went to Washington, D.C. then October 67 for a two-week training session, and then got on the plane, went to, I think we flew out of Fort Ord, California. I think that's where we went to California for 2 days until we got everything settled and I guess paperwork or whatever, and then flew from California into Tan Sanhut Air Base in South Vietnam.
Okay. Any friends go with you?
This one friend who I guess basically talked me into it. Yeah, she and I went to Washington. We went in the same class. There were different classes. I think people went in groups of probably like 18 to 20. There were 18 to 20 of us in a class, what they call classes. And I think the classes at the time I was involved were every 6 weeks or so. Classes held in Washington, D.C. and then going overseas.
So you're in New Jersey. Where'd you go to sign up or enlist? Let's use that term.
Oh, good question. I must have been Washington, D.C. I think, I don't remember that. Thinking maybe I flew from Newark Airport, Newark International Airport, to Washington, D.C., and now that I think about it, probably Red Cross headquarters in Washington, D.C.,
okay.
And basically interviewed there, flew back home, and then got the letter that I was accepted, and then back to Washington for the two-week training session. Yeah.
So you're planning on joining this organization.
Mm-hmm.
What did you think your life was going to be like after you joined?
I don't think I gave it much thought. After graduation, this friend who ended up, Tosh, ended up going to Vietnam with me. She and I, and I think there were five of us, drove to California, got jobs in California. Basically, one of the persons we graduated with from Montclair, his name is Rick, he was going in the Peace Corps. And he needed to leave from the Peace Corps, or leave for the Peace Corps from, must have been San Francisco. So there were five of us, including Rick and Tosh and myself, who drove to California, dropped Rick off. He went in the Peace Corps. The rest of us went to LA and worked until it was time to go to Washington, D.C. for the training. I must have known when I went to California that I was going to be in Washington then in October. I think I pretty much knew that. So California for the summer was just, I don't know, California for the summer, I'm not sure. We all worked, we all had jobs, we all got jobs out there, and then kind of dribbled back to the East Coast.
Okay, so when you signed on the dotted line,
yeah,
how long was that commitment for?
1 year service in, or more or less 1 year service in Vietnam, 2 weeks in training in Washington, D.C., and then 1 year once we got in country.
Okay. So now you're in, and your initial training, what do you remember about that?
The training was in Washington, D.C. That was the two-week deal. What we ended up doing during that time was we all had to present a program, which is what we ended up doing, visiting troops and whatever. We all made and presented a program. We learned different military insignias, Army, Navy, Air Force, Marines, you know, all the different insignias, and then were exposed to the ranks. The color indications as to, in the Army's second lieutenant, first lieutenant, colonel, full bird, I don't know, all of them, major, whatever, somewhere in there. And so that was a two-week session, introduction, I guess, to armed services, and then introduction to, I guess, a map of Vietnam, because we knew. At the very end, we knew where we were going to be stationed and we're all split up, or most of us were split up, to base camps that already had Red Cross centers or whatever. And we knew that. So I don't know what I think that's about it. Just information about the service, information about the programs we were going to be presenting. And like I said, the very, very last day, I think we found out where we were going. So, and Vietnam is long and narrow. There were so many different climate changes and whatever. I think it was kind of hard for anybody to say exactly what we were getting into, depending on where we ended up. So I think that was kind of not emphasized at all in Washington.
So you're going for this training. Mm-hmm. Is this done at a military base? Is this done at the Red Cross? You guys have apartments? Or?
I think it was at the Red Cross. You are really digging into my brain here. Pretty sure we were at the Red Cross Center. It was kind of a classroom setting, tables and all. And then we stayed at some hotel in Washington, D.C. I don't remember.
Okay.
That's too much digging for me.
Well, I just want to give people a good background.
I don't remember that. Pardon?
Just giving people a good background.
Yeah, right.
Okay, so you've completed your training in Washington, D.C. Mm-hmm. Did you travel to any military bases before you went overseas to kind of prep?
I believe we flew out of Fort Ord, and that was, I mean, the reason for that was not anything to do with the military, except that, I mean, we didn't do anything with the military. All we did was fly a commercial plane, as far as I remember, but everybody on the plane was servicemen or Red Cross. The 18 or 19 who were in my class in Washington, D.C., were all in the same plane together, and the rest of the 300 were military men. I don't think there are any other women other than the flight attendants on board. So yeah, we stayed in San Francisco at some type of a hotel for two nights, I believe, and then got on the plane and took off. So no, we didn't do military installation in California at all.
So you had to get all your shots and everything like everybody else did?
Oh yeah, that. Oh, one time that I was, as I said, I was in California that summer, needed to get those shots, and it was kind of weird. I had to get, I think it was a bubonic plague shot, just all these weird shots for the 60s anyway. I had left my apartment in downtown LA, was walking to like a storefront type doctor's office that I was going to get the shot at, and there was a peace demonstration. I'm walking on the street, the sidewalk, one side, and coming at me were all these people for a peace demonstration. And I just saw the sheer numbers, and then people started pushing and shoving. And I thought I was going to go through a plate glass window because I was going the opposite direction, trying to stay against the building. And people started pushing and shoving and knocking people over, and I thought, there's something wrong here. There's a little disconnect. I'm getting the shot to go, and they're demonstrating against it. It was just kind of a, what's going on here? You know, just like I said, a disconnect or something with reality or whatever. But that is one thing that really stands out in my mind as far as shots are concerned. I know I got a bunch of them, but that was the one that, I think just the circumstances rather than anything else.
So what years did you serve in Vietnam?
1967 to 68. Training, you know, I thought about this. I think one of your questions or whatever. I believe I was there for two Thanksgivings. So I went to Washington, D.C. for the training in October and flew out after 2 weeks training. I guess I'm not really sure, but I was in Vietnam for that Thanksgiving, and then I came back. I was there again for a Thanksgiving of 68, but I was not there for Christmas of 68. So the exact dates, the more I thought about it, I'm trying to figure out, I don't know exactly how long, but I came back before Christmas of 68.
Okay.
Yeah, so two Thanksgivings and one Christmas I was there.
So you're on your way to Vietnam. Mm-hmm. You're on the plane. Nervous?
I don't think I knew enough to be nervous. You know, let's face it, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, you're all invincible. So nothing's going to happen. It's just going to, everything's going to work out and everything's going to be fine. And I think that was probably my mindset. I don't remember being nervous. I don't remember being scared. This was it. This is what I was going to do. And like I said, invincible. Everybody's invincible at that age, you know? So I think that was my idea.
Okay, so you land in Vietnam. Where was your first duty station?
Flew into Tan Sanut Air Base, or I guess Air Base, or whatever it was. Airport, I guess, I'm not sure. It was all military, though. My recollection is all military. The first place that I went to then was in Quy Nhon, which is along the coast, beautiful area, probably about halfway up, I think, the country. The whole country, North Vietnam, South Vietnam. So, yeah, in Quy Nhon. That was my first station.
So you get there, you said, in October.
October or November, I'm not sure. Like I said, I just believe that I was in Vietnam for two Thanksgivings. So somewhere from October, 2 weeks in Washington to over. I don't know. I was really thinking about that last night. I don't know. I don't know what it was.
What were your living conditions like?
Oh, Quy Nhon was, we lived in, the General's Compound, maybe it's called. I'm not sure. It was a bunch of trailers. There were six Red Cross girls living there, three of us in each trailer. The trailers were, I mean, they were old. They were sparse. Three little bedrooms. We did have air conditioning. It was not the worst place I was at by any means, and it was okay. It was all right.
So you had a separate compound away from the soldiers or the troops?
Quy Nhon was kind of spread out. The military part of Quy Nhon that I recollect was spread out. Like I said, the one end was the General's Compound, but in that compound there were troops. There was a mess hall. I'm trying to picture it. So we weren't away from all the troops, but there were different, I guess, areas. There was artillery. It was a support area. Quy Nhon was first logistics or first logistical or whatever support area. It had that thing with the arrow on it. I don't know what those badges
shoulder
were.
Patch.
Yes. Support, right?
Right.
Yes. And we had a Red Cross Center there, Red Cross Recreation Center, and we did take, an armed person came and got us every morning and took us to the Red Cross Center and then brought us back again after it closed at, 9 o'clock at night or whatever. Yeah.
So you're in a combat zone.
Yeah. Yeah. That was not the worst, though. That was Quy Nhon. That was support. Yes. Yep.
So did you spend your whole time at Quy Nhon, or did you?
No, I was in Quy Nhon until, I'm thinking, March or April. I was in Quy Nhon for Tet. What's that, the end of January, beginning of February,
right,
whatever that time
January.
Frame is. Yeah, because the radio station was overrun during Tet, and we were quarantined, or whatever the word is, at our billet area. We did not go out for probably a week and a half, 2 weeks around Tet. So that was the first duty station. That was where I was, so that was okay. Then I was transferred, like I said, I don't know, March or April, I was transferred to LIK, which was with the Big Red One, the 1st Infantry Division, and that was around Saigon. I'm not sure of the direction from Saigon, but it was in that...
southern part.
Yeah, southern part. Is that I Corps, or is that 3 Corps, or 4 Corps? I don't even know anymore. My memory's not so good. But yeah, down towards Saigon, or outside of Saigon, with the 1st Infantry Division.
Okay, so while you're going back to Quinyan, what were you doing every day?
There were 6 of us, as I said. Yeah, 6 of us, 3 in each trailer. We ran the Red Cross Center. We had the Red Cross Center open from 8:30-ish in the morning till like 9 o'clock at night. The Red Cross Center had a couple ping pong tables, had a couple pool tables, always had a pot of coffee, always had Kool-Aid, always had had cookies or whatever were sent to us from people in the States. We would get bags of, we call them ditty bags, little bags with cards in them, playing cards, and notes from people in the United States, and candy, packages of Kool-Aid, gum, comfort pack type things. We always had those to give out. There was always a card game going on somewhere. So we did that. That center was open 7 days a week, like I said, from morning till 9 at night-ish or so. In addition to that, there were 2 people in the center at all times, 2 Red Cross girls in the center at all times, and then the other 4 of us would be out on what we called runs, and those would be visiting troops in motor pools, flight lines, any type of work area where the troops would be, where the Army, Navy, whatever would be. We visited those within the Quinyan compound area. We also visited, there was a Seabees group at the tip of the South China Sea where we were. It kind of had like a little peninsula type thing or whatever. So we used to take a mic boat across to visit the troops there and met in their mess halls or wherever they were assembled, and then put on these programs like I had mentioned that we had done in Washington, D.C. The programs were made up of games. They were usually an hour. They're made up of some type of icebreaker, you know, the deal with the rubber band and the stuff with the cigarette box. You gotta knock it over or something, just some goofy things. And those were kind of like we considered icebreakers. We always had something like that to start the program, and then we always had a program, the 45-minute program or whatever. They were usually based on TV shows. There was a program that I had made up. I had done on Jeopardy and, you know, the different categories and the questions, and we always divide everybody up into teams, and everybody's yelling and screaming the answers, you know, just something to... get their mind off whatever was going on. So we had that. We had programs on cars. We had programs on perfume. We had programs on movie stars, movies, anything we could think of at the time that hadn't been done. So we traveled with these canvas bags, OD, green mm-hmm. canvas bags. And everything had to fit in that canvas bag. It was probably about this big. I don't know, a couple feet by a couple feet, and everything had to fit in there. So that, and then at the end we would give out whatever we had, whatever people had sent us in the boxes, the goodie boxes, whatever from home. And sometimes they were food, sometimes they were, I don't know, whatever anybody had, whatever they sent us.
So when you're with the troops, stuff. So you're eating right in the mess hall with them and everything.
Oh yeah. In fact, most of the time we served in the mess hall. We would go in the mess hall and serve the food and whatever. So yeah, we did that. If we're on the flight line, we served coffee and Kool-Aid at 6 o'clock in the morning if we went out there or whatever. So yeah. yes. And then also on those runs from Quinyan, we used to visit some fire bases too. We took choppers most of the time. Of the four people who went on the two runs, I think one was kind of arranged to be visiting places in Quinyan, like I said, the military bases in Quinyan. The other two, in most cases, were on helicopters visiting fire bases, LZs, whatever, wherever anybody wanted us to come.
So you were where the troops were?
Yeah, yes, basically.
Fire bases, detachments, mm-hmm. main base, wherever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So you're at a fire base. You're eating the same food they're eating.
Yep. Yep. Sometimes we came in on the choppers that brought, you know, sometimes they got hot food. Or, you know, in those canisters, whatever mm-hmm. they were, the big honking green canisters. So sometimes we came in on those supply helicopters and we would serve them, or we ate sea rations or LRPs or the long range reconnaissance, whatever those packages were yep. that you add water to. Yep. Yeah, we ate those. Yeah.
So you were right with them doing what they did and came under fire every so often.
Yeah, yeah, we did. Unfortunately, that was sometimes poor planning, but it's history.
Okay, what was your basic job or assignment while you were in Vietnam? Just
depending on where we were stationed, in Lai Kae, there was not a Red Cross Center. There was a library type part of a building. And we kept, like I said, people would send us paperbacks and all kinds of books and all kinds of that stuff, writing paper and pens and whatever. So in Lai Kae, my second duty station, there was no Red Cross Center, so we were out on choppers almost every day, with the exception, I think there were five of us there in Lai Kae. And I'm thinking one was kind of at the library type thing, that little room that we had. The rest of us were out on runs visiting the troops again, LZ, landing zones or artillery bases or wherever they were. So that part in Lai Kae, that group was more what we considered mobile. We were air mobile. We were going out most of the time. And that was probably the hottest place we were in, hot for artillery, because we had a number of rocket attacks and mortar attacks and whatever from there. In fact, the four or five Red Cross people, people kind of came and went with temporary duties and all TDYs, and so there were Red Cross personnel coming and going, so I'm not exactly sure how many were at each place in a particular time. But we were evacuated from there. We were in the bunker most of the time. There's a bunker right outside our door. We, in Lai Kae, we lived in a French villa, and that's using the term rather loosely. You know what a French villa is nowadays. It probably was very nice at the time. It was a stone structure, but no windows. Place for windows, no, nothing like that. And there were two separate bedrooms. There was a living room, there was a kitchen off the back, there was our bathroom, if you can call it that. And then out the other side, there was a bunker. So yeah, we spent a lot of time in Lai Kae in the bunker. But we had good times too. It was not all bad times. We had some good times there too.
So not being rocketed at night, what was your everyday life like when you got up? Would you overnight out at the fire bases, or would you come back?
I never did. Some did, probably later on in the 70s. I was there 67, 68. I believe some people got socked in with weather. So yes, they ended up staying overnight, particularly if they were flying up towards the DMZ. And the further north the troops went, I think the more chance of them staying overnight, just because of the flight time and being socked in because of the weather. That's my recollection anyway. I never stayed overnight anyway. I was TDY in a couple places and stayed over, but not not on a run. What we called were runs, not on a run. I never did that. I think probably because that when I was in Lycée, we were in an area with the 1st Infantry Division, so that's who we visited every day. So we would get up in the morning and maybe we had hot water, maybe we didn't, depending on the bladder or the heat or how much sun we had. Take a hot shower, cold shower, whatever. Yeah, things were different. And then we would go to one of the mess halls and most of the time we would serve. Well, I shouldn't say most of the time, a lot of the times we would serve. Otherwise eat with whoever was there, sat at the tables with the guys, ate, got our assignment for the day, where you were going, what you were doing, get the program bag, and every place had two or three or four programs, depending on the size of the base where we were, of course, and get the bag, go out to the heliport, or whatever we called them then, get on the chopper, go away, and then start doing our thing, giving out our treasures, whatever were sent to us from home, and yep, that's what we did.
So the choppers that you went out on, door gunners and everything?
Yeah.
War zone?
They were basically Hueys, I think. Mm-hmm. Yep, we had the guns on either side. Yep, we were in the back in that bench seat. And then, what is it, the pilot and co-pilot in the front? So, yeah, just a regular Huey.
No special Red Cross markings on them or anything?
No. The choppers with the Red Cross on them were medevacs or whatever. I was never on a medevac.
But yet you were part of the Red Cross?
Yes. Yeah, but not... Yes, we were.
Read a lot of letters home?
I did in the beginning. And maybe maybe this is the same as college students or something. I did in the beginning. I was faithful in writing and faithful, and I kept a journal. And I think that lasted about a month and a half or so. And then it was like, oh, I was so tired and so... I mean, we were busy from morning to night. It was just a lot to do to keep doing what we were doing. We were on probably 6 to 7 days a week, and it was tiresome. It was very tiresome. So, yep.
So, did you receive any care packages from home?
Yeah, so that was one of the bad things that I got. My third duty station was in Ankei. I had gotten a care package from home, and inside were Cheetos or something. So one night I was laying in bed, my cot, whatever, and I was eating the Cheetos laying in bed. I was so tired, I can't remember. And I fell asleep with my hand over the side of the cot, and that's when I was nibbled by a rat. And I should have washed, I know, I shouldn't have been eating in bed, you know, all those things go through your mind afterwards, shouldn't. But yes, that's when I was nibbled by the rat, and so I never did that again. Thanks for the care package, but this
but
is what happened.
One. Yeah. Okay.
Yes.
The post exchange and the base exchange geared for males, mm-hmm. geared for the soldiers. Were you able to get, you know, personal and other supply items?
Most of the time we were. Most of the time we were, like Quinyon had a hospital right there, what was it, 67th Evac or something? In Quinyon, they had the ship out in the South China Sea. So yeah, there were nurses, military nurses I had stationed in almost every place I was. But the stuff in the PX, you know, you could get cameras, you could get tape decks at the time, mm-hmm. tape recorders, tape decks. You could get speakers and amplifiers and all this electronic stuff. sometimes you couldn't get soap. we just need soap. We just need creature comforts, I guess. Mm-hmm. We didn't need the cameras and the zoom lenses and the this and the that and whatever. But for the most part, the PXs were stocked okay. And really, it depended on what they got, too. I don't know, at one time in the PX, we could not get laundry detergent. And I went into town one day, I think it was in Anquet, and there is a display, I think, 5 bottles of Tide on the black market. And I thought, wow. Okay, something's wrong with that picture. That kind of stands out in my mind, too. So it was, oh, okay. It is what it is. Again, one more time, it is what it is. So, but yeah, most of the time it was fine. No problem.
Were there times that you felt homesick or stressed while you were over there?
Oh, I don't think I was really homesick. Stress, yeah. Yeah. I think my worst duty station, I was only there for about a month, was Lycay with the rockets. And I think the worst part in Lycay was we were in the bunker, which was, like I said, just outside the door to this French villa where we lived. And rocket attack all over, all clear sign. We came into our living quarters, and there was a piece of shrapnel on my bed, right on my bed, right on top of the poncho liner. There was a piece of shrapnel that had come through the ceiling, and I was like, oh my, this is not the best situation. And you know, the friend of mine who was stationed with me then, she was visiting me a couple weeks ago. You met her, Barb, mm-hmm. at the Heroes Cafe. And she told me something that I had never heard before. She said, you know, we came in and she said to me, I saw that piece of shrapnel on your bed. And I thought, whew, it's not on my bed. She said, my bed was 2 feet away from yours. I don't know what I was thinking. But that was her mindset at the time that, oh, it's on Diane's bed. It's not on my bed. So, but that, I think that Lycay was the most stressful. We were not in a center, which was kind of calm during the day. We were on runs, we were out flying around doing our thing, and knowing that the enemy was many places around us, that was probably the most stressful or most war-stressed situation. That was probably the worst.
So how many duty stations did you have in Vietnam?
Three. The first one was Quy Nhon by the South China Sea. Beautiful area, very, very nice. And then the second one was Lycay, which was more in country. And that was where the Michelin rubber plantations were. That's where they did, I remember reading or seeing or whatever, that's where they did a lot of the spraying for Agent Orange, because it was so thick, and the plantations and all, there was so much foliage, there was so much green that they really sprayed those areas. And so that was Lycay. That was, like I said, the worst part safety-wise, although it was still good. I mean, it was still fine. And then I was in Anquet, which is the Central Highlands, closer to Quy Nhon. Quy Nhon was on the coast. Anquet was in the mountain pass. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, the convoys would come through there and everything, through the Anquet Pass. So that's where I was for the last, I guess, 5 months, 6 months. April through December, end of November, beginning of December when I left. Yeah, Anquet. And Anquet had a recreation center, and we also did a lot of visiting out in the field. I'm trying to think how many were stationed. I think there were eight or nine of us in Onk, but that was a bigger base camp, bigger area. That was with the 1st Air Cav was there and the 173rd Airborne. So it was kind of, I think, kind of different to have both those groups there. But 1st Air Cav was on its way up north to, is that Camp Evans or whatever that was? Mm-hmm. I'm not sure. They were on their, kind of on the way out. But there are a lot of 1st Cav were still coming back through there to Deros or whatever to get out. So that was still considered their base camp, but like I said, the 173rd was there as well. And that was much bigger than Lyke. We lived in a compound with the nurses. It was kind of a O-shaped building. All of the individual rooms were around the outside. The middle was opened up. We had like drainage ditches almost. I don't know what was there before we were there. But the water, the rainwater, whatever, would come through there, and that was the middle. So we lived with the nurses then in Onk. So that was kind of a different, maybe that was the 67th evac, I'm not sure. I don't know, I can't remember all that stuff. But we were with nurses, and there was a big hospital at Onk. And I can remember the sound of helicopters coming in. And whatever.
So you said one of the places you were stationed, a lot of Agent Orange. So you came in contact with Agent Orange.
Oh, I don't think, you know, this is not government correct or whatever. I don't know who's watching this, but I don't think you could be there and not come in contact with Agent Orange. I mean, you spray something from how many feet up, it just kind of floats all over. It does. And I mean, I swam in rivers. I washed myself in rainwater, brushed our teeth every morning from the eave or the place where it dripped down from the roof of the billet, and how could you not end up being exposed to Agent Orange? It was just all around. And like I said, was the rubber plantation, and I don't know how many drums, gallons, thousands of gallons, hundreds of thousands of gallons were dumped on that area. That was the purpose, kill everything, or kill vegetation, which obviously kills other things too. Not PC, I know, but reality.
Yes.
I guess, I don't know.
Did you carry any reminders of home with you?
You know, when I graduated from high school, now that you mention that, when I graduated from high school, I got a portable radio. We're talking the 60s, so that was a big deal.
Yes, yes.
So I got this portable radio that I had brought with me with a 9-volt battery. I had a bunch of batteries. And I had it, and I used it. And when I had a little alarm clock, too. Both those things were stolen from me in Quinyan. The battery, or the radio disappeared, the alarm clock disappeared. It was like, yeah, really? So that's what I tried to carry with me, but no good luck charms or anything like that. No.
Okay. How'd you pass the time?
I don't think we had any. We were busy almost all the time. We were busy most of the time, and I think when we weren't busy, I was zonked out. I was out. Actually, though, when I was in Onk, my last duty station, that was probably the easiest because there were eight or nine of us there. I don't know. It seemed as though I wasn't so busy, and so I worked in an orphanage. A Vietnamese orphanage, went there probably about one day a week, and that lasted for a couple months. And basically it was just helping out wherever it was run by nuns. It was Onk City, I don't know for sure. And just went there and worked with the kids and with the nurses and fed or held or whatever the orphans, Vietnamese orphans.
So pretty much all Vietnamese orphans or their Amerasian children?
Probably a combination. By that time, 67, 68, there were a lot of kids who had very Western features and a couple blonde hair, blue-eyed babies, and yeah, there were a lot of combinations. Yes. Yep.
There were a lot of orphanages in Vietnam.
I'm sorry?
There were a lot of orphanages in Vietnam.
Yes. Oh, yeah. Yeah, there were. And there were a lot of, the orphanage that I volunteered at was run by nuns. Some spoke kind of a broken English. Most of them, I guess I didn't know that many of them, were, I think, of French origin. So I think some of them spoke French and Vietnamese, of course, but I didn't do very well with the languages. I'm not a language person.
So those nuns that spoke French and stuff, they've been there quite a while.
I would think so. My remembrance of them now, of course, I was 22. My remembrance is that they were old, but it's all relative. I am old now compared to some people. And, I mean, you know, you're looking at it through the eyes of a 22-year-old. So.
Exactly.
Whatever it is.
So were you ever able to see a USO show?
I did that first. The only Christmas I was there, we saw the Bob Hope show. I shook hands with Bob Hope. And Margaret was there. She was in that show. Is it Ann Margaret? I think it was Ann Margaret. Yep. So flew to Phuket Air Base. That was one of our runs from Quy Nhon. We went to Phuket Air Force Base and did presentations, programs throughout different areas on that base camp. But that's where Bob Hope was. So there were all kinds of people were there. Yeah, so that was my USO show. That was it. It was very, very nice, very nice.
So remember it.
Oh, I do remember. I remember shaking hands with Bob Hope. He was such a trooper. He was wonderful. Wonderful. I have never heard anything bad about him. Of course, we didn't have Skype and Facebook and the internet and everything, but I never heard anything bad about him. And he was very, very gracious to the troops. He put on a wonderful show, met with people afterward. That's when I met with him. They were on their way someplace. We were going to get on the chopper to go back to Quy Nhon, and our paths just kind of crossed. It was not a It was a happenstance. It was not a planned thing or anything. It was like, oh, there's Bob Hope, yay! So that was nice. That was the high point.
So what were some of your other good memories about over there?
Oh, my. I made lots of good friends among the Red Cross people. Lots of good friends. And the Red Cross people, at least I remember their names. I know their names. Lots of wonderful, wonderful GIs. Service people, I don't remember names. I think at the time you just didn't, and it was not a conscious thing at that time. But now, you know, looking back, and psychologists and psychiatrists say you didn't learn people's names because you didn't want to know them because they might not be there the next time. And maybe that was it. That was not a conscious effort on my part. It was just we saw so many people. We saw so many men in one day. Sometimes we would see 1,000 guys in one day, and it was amazing. It was just amazing. Sometimes you wouldn't see that many, but sometimes there were that many. So it was good getting to know them in Red Cross centers. Sometimes they would be back from the field for 2 days or 3 days and come into the center, and you would kind of get to know them for 2 or 3 days, and then they'd be gone. And then another group would come back for a stand down or whatever and get to know them then, and then they were gone. So very, very, very nice people. Almost everybody was just fantastic. We were in it together. You know, it was kind of that idea. So That was good. That was wonderful. And, you know, serving in the mess tents, that was very good, too. I mean, I'm not saying that was a bad job or anything. On the flight lines, yep, it was all good. I think it was all good. Tiring, but very good. Very, very good, yes.
Other ladies that you served with, other donut dollies, stay in touch with them at all?
Yes, yes. Went to a convention, I guess you would call it, in North Carolina, South Carolina in May. Went out and visited there. There's usually some type of a gathering in Washington, D.C. over Veterans Day. I've done that. I am not going this Veterans Day, but I was there a couple years ago. I was there for the dedication for the Women's Memorial. We keep in contact with each other. Last fall, I think maybe this year, I met up with three others and we did a kind of a bike tour, or not a bike tour, a car tour up Washington, Oregon area, up in that area. We rented a car and just kind of traveled around and did some hiking, did some stuff like that. So I am in contact. And Barb was visiting me, my friend Barb. We were stationed in Lycay together. We kind of kept in touch. She was not in my training class to go over. I think she came after me, but we kept in touch. She was from Michigan, Battle Creek area. So when I would drive to Jersey, I would stop and see her. When she went someplace, she would stop and see me. So our kids met each other, met the other kids, and they don't remember, of course, that was a long time ago. But yes, I've kept in contact with her, kept in contact with, I would say, 50 or 60 of them.
I know there's websites out there now that have pictures and
right,
where everybody's
right.
at. You visit those quite a bit? Those websites just
No. What I do in the 80s when one of the first parades that I knew about was a welcome home parade in Chicago, and I went to that. That was, other than Barb in Michigan, I think that was the first time that I had seen a lot of the people who I was stationed with. Well, that's not true. My friend from New Jersey, I've kept in contact with her. But we were friends for a long time before that. But Barb in Michigan, I've kept in contact with her. And then the 80s, probably the 80s started where people were more accepting of Vietnam vets and more understanding and that type of stuff. So that's where, like I said, that first parade in Chicago, I went to that. And I think that's the first time where I met up with women that I had been stationed with and other women. I mean, you know, you're in a group, maybe the year that you're there, well, in Quinyan there were six of us, in Lycay there were four or five of us, in Ankay there were eight of us. So I mean, how many people do you get to meet, live with, whatever, for a year? I mean, even though you're there a year, you don't have interaction with that many Red Cross people, because as you're going someplace else, they're coming someplace else. So it's and of course they were, what was it, 60, whatever, 364 till 72 that there were Red Cross people there. So they're, in addition to not being stationed with everybody throughout the year, you're there for 6 or 7 years as well. There were 600 people. So you really didn't get to know that many. But then going to reunions and, like I said, the parade and conferences and conventions and all, you get to know other people, other women who were stationed there.
So while you were over in Vietnam, were you able to take leave or go
yes.
on R&R?
Yep. We did R&R. My first R&R was Australia. That was shortly after I was nibbled, I think. No, that's not right. The first one, where did I go first? First one maybe was Bangkok. I did a couple of R&Rs. First one was, where one of them was Bangkok. Oh, and that I went with my friend from Jersey, Tosh, who I went in with. I was never stationed with her, and the two of us decided we would go to Bangkok together. So we put in and got our orders and plane tickets and everything. And we went there and we were riding in a rickshaw type situation. And one of the cars, and they're real teeny tiny little cars there anyway, and one of the cars backfired. I was on the floor of that rickshaw in nanoseconds. It was just my mindset at the time. That it was incoming or whatever, there was a rocket attack, mortar attack, it was just your body automatically takes over. And just from that situation, I can say PTSD has got to be just terrible. Anything can set it off, anything. I mean, if that's the effect it had on me, and I mean, I wasn't even in combat. I was not in a lot of those really bad places. But boy, I was... That just set me off. That set me off in Bangkok. And I mean, there was no military around. It was nothing. It was just my automatic response to get down. So it was, ooh, that was not so good. But Bangkok was fun. It was good. We rode the elephants, you know, did all the touristy stuff that you do in Bangkok. I did have an opportunity to go to Australia. And that was shortly after I was nibbled by the rat. And again, I'm saying PTSD is terrible. I was nibbled by that rat. I think I left country, had it been within a week, into Australia. A number of people in Australia would go to the airports, basically, and take service people into their homes for their 5-day, 6-day, whatever it was, R&R. And that's what happened. A very, very nice couple came and took both Tosh and I to their house in Australia. But just from the rat nibbling, it was a beautiful home. I think I had one of those pictures. Beautiful home, brick home. I mean, compared to where we were, it was gorgeous anyway, but a brick home, circular drive in front, all the plants and everything. And I think I sat up the whole time because I swore I saw rats crawling around the room I was in. It was, again, your mindset is just, mind plays goofy tricks on you. So, like I said, I cannot imagine what someone who was out in the boonies and had those conditions continuously, I can't imagine that, because this was a beautiful, beautiful home. And here I saw these little critters running around. So I sat up, like I said, however long I was there with the light on, slept if I slept. And I can remember then the next days, we went skiing. This was in August, and we went snow skiing, you know, opposite, I don't know, southern hemisphere, whatever. Anyway, it was snow. We went skiing. I had my parents mail me my ski stuff. We went skiing, and I can remember coming in from the slopes, and I was just, I thought I was going to fall asleep at the table. You know, fall asleep right into the mashed potatoes because I was getting bad sleep at night, so... That was unfortunate. And I did get to Hong Kong. That was good. And then on the way back from Vietnam, I stopped in Japan. I had a friend who was living in a little Japanese house, and I went and visited her and her husband. And he was in the military, but they lived not on base. So I went and visited her for a couple days. So I did get a chance to go to Japan as well. So that was good. I had a good chance to travel. Very, very nice. Very nice opportunities. Yep.
So when were you able to finally come home?
It was just before Christmas, 1968. Just before Christmas, I flew into Travis Air Force Base. What's that, Washington? State of Washington?
I believe so.
I think into Travis, and then took a flight to Chicago, landed in Chicago, and then drove with a friend back to New Jersey, and I made it to Jersey, I don't know, a couple days before Christmas. So, yep. My mother had told everybody that I was coming home, all the relatives and neighborhood and everything were in. Oh, I have to tell you this. Before I left, my sister had gotten this cat. And it was kind of a wild, I thought it was a wild cat. And I like cats. I mean, you know, I'm friendly with cats. I really like them. So, but she got this cat that was really kind of weird. So it never liked me to start with. When I kept back from Vietnam, gone for over a year, because from Washington, D.C., we went right over, gone for over a year, sitting in the kitchen, no shoes on, probably 15 people in the kitchen, that damn cat comes over and bites me in the foot. I didn't say a word. I never heard it, never anything. He came right over and just got me. So, that was my welcome home. A bite in the foot. Oh, my.
Did you go back to school after the you got out?
Yeah, I did, but basically because I needed to maintain a license. I did get a master's degree at UW-Stout. Certain requirements, certain things, classes you need to take, whatever, for teaching to maintain a license, all that kind of stuff. So yeah, I did get my master's. And then I got my master's at Whitewater. That's what it is. I got my master's at Whitewater. And then I got an ed specialist at Stout, UW-Stout, yeah.
Okay, so what work did you do after you got done with all your education?
Taught. First of all, I got back and worked for some type of chemical company in Janesville, and was going to school at night for my master's. Worked in the summer at the playgrounds, you know, the usual playgrounds in Whitewater. Lived in Whitewater for a while. Taught at Evansville High School for 2 years, then moved to Rapids, taught at Assumption, taught at Mid-State for the rest of the time. Yep. And then got my realty license in the 70s sometime, and then did real estate too.
What did you learn from the donut dollies that served you the best?
Don't sweat the small stuff. It was, you know, if you did something wrong, it was like, what are they going to do, send me to Vietnam? You know, it was like, what can you threaten me with now? That was kind of a theme or whatever. If something happens, yeah, what are they going to do, send us to Vietnam? Or, you know, something like that. So, yeah, I mean, you see some things that are going on. Some people get tied up and whatever for stuff that doesn't amount to a hill of beans. It just plain old doesn't. I guess maybe that was kind of my thought process or thoughts when I got back, that none of this stuff matters. It doesn't. It's just garbage. It's just baloney. So I think I was in that mode for a while. And then it was almost like everything mattered. And it was, something's got to give. I don't know. Yeah. Not sure.
You started a Heroes Cafe in Stevens Point.
Absolutely. Heroes Cafe, Portage County. Yes.
Tell us about it.
We meet at the Lincoln Center. We meet first and third Thursday of the month. Tomorrow is the first one, or the next one. 8:30 to 11, open to police, firefighters, EMT, or EMS support, and veterans. And yep, coffee, donuts, kind of like deja vu, I'm back with the coffee and donuts again. Actually, we were called Donut Dollies based on World War II, where they really did make and give donuts out. They didn't. But in Vietnam, it was so hot. There was no way you're going to make donuts. Kool-Aid was, I mean, coffee wasn't even okay to wake you up or whatever, but Kool-Aid was the drink of the day there. Besides, there were a lot of drugs, there were a lot of alcohol problems and everything, but I guess, considering what was going on, was a little different. But yeah, the American Heroes Cafe, first and third Thursday of the month, Lincoln Center, 8:30 to 11, police, firefighters, EMS, support, and veterans. Coffee, donuts, treats, whatever the good public gives us. Great support in Stevens Point for American Heroes Cafe.
And
lots
good fellowship.
Of contributions and everything. Good fellowship, yep, absolutely, yes. Hopefully we'll get to the same numbers as Wisconsin Rapids does.
They all start small and work their way up.
Yes.
Yes. Anything else you'd like to talk about your service?
I don't think so. that's a question. No, I think your question's pretty much covered just about everything. I'll probably think of something as I'm going out the driveway, out the parking lot, whatever, but no, I think that's probably it. I guess, if anything, I would be very, maybe remiss if I didn't mention the differences in Afghanistan, Iraq situation versus Vietnam veterans, or Iraq, Afghanistan veterans versus Vietnam veterans. Vietnam veterans came back to, you know, you heard the stories of the spitting and the baby killer name calling and all that crap that went on. That's true, that really did happen. I came back to Travis with my friend. We went in the bathroom, took off our uniforms, had something with us, and I literally set fire to my uniform. That was the end of the Red Cross, not the Red Cross, that was the end of maybe that part of my life or whatever in my mind. That was the end of it. I was not admitting to anything. And I mean, that really did happen. That was, and to take some of those guys who had been in the boonies for a year, 6 months, a month, 2 weeks, and fly them out and into the middle of civilization was so, so very wrong. I mean, my experience going to Bangkok with the car backfiring is just a blip on the screen of what some of those guys, or a lot of those guys, experienced. It's just, it's got to be understanding and just realizing that that is not, and I think the government realizes, like I said, with Iraq and Afghanistan, and places like that, the return is a little different. My son is in the service right now. He is in Fort Carson, Colorado, and he has been to Iraq, Afghanistan, Bosnia, Kuwait, Korea before that, those places. And I'm thinking the mental health of those people is so much better than what the Vietnam vet experienced. Or God help, I hope it's a lot better than what the Vietnam veterans experienced, because you can't move a person from being in total fear of their lives into the middle of Chicago or backwoods this or camping here or whatever with no psychological problems. That was so ridiculous. I can remember when we came back, went to Whitewater, and some friends said, we were at a party, and some friends said, oh, I haven't seen you for a while, or, you know, this, where have you been? What's going on? And I would say, if I said I was in Vietnam, easiest way to clear a room. Easiest way to clear a room. Somebody heard that and they were out of your area. They didn't want to know what was going on. They didn't know what you want to know what you did, didn't want to know where you were, any of that stuff. And that was a big part of me. And then, I mean, hearing on the plane, you know, ditch your uniform, and then you get off the plane, there's protesters marching all around, and this is what this is what you gave a year of your life for, to come back to something like this? So I guess, I don't know, and maybe that was my thought process at the time, that nothing matters, you know, you're back, don't sweat the small stuff again. Maybe that was my thought process. But then after a couple of situations like that where people would say, you know, where were you, whatever, what's going on and everything, and you would answer, then they would almost like shun you. I never even told anybody I was there. Never. What have you been doing? Oh, nothing. Just kind of hanging around, just doing nothing. And that became the thing. That was the way you responded. And I guess maybe this is a good example. I went to that LZ Lambeau a couple years ago in Green Bay, and I was talking to some guys there, and there were two guys that were kind of sitting at the table, you know, chatting and all, and one guy looked at the other one and said, you know, I have worked with this guy for 30 years, 25 years, 30 years, worked right next to him. I never knew he was a Vietnam veteran. Because nobody said it. Nobody would admit to it because of the negative, terrible negative reactions that Vietnam vets get. So that was just kind of like a, yep, I believe you, another aha moment. So yeah, that was unfortunate, but the way it is.
So you had the same treatment, so to say, as a soldier did?
Oh,
I
would think the soldiers were way, way worse than the treatment I got, because I think I was able to be assimilated, if that's the right word, back into life again, easier than some, particularly combat veterans. Holy cripes, I can't imagine what they went through. I can't imagine what it was like. And I mean, you know, just my own experience with being in Bangkok, like I said, with the car backfiring, in Australia with the seeing the rats. I mean, that's so minor. That's so little compared to what other people have gone through. So, yeah, that's really, really too bad. So, anyway.
And thank you for your service.
Thank you for your service, too.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for watching.